Now, how do you improve financial literacy among young people and help them become the entrepreneurs of the future?
Well, one organisation that's been successful in this area is MyBank. Now, after 9 years in business, it's reached 150,000 young people in the UK.
And it has a presence in 7 countries, from France to Uganda.
And it helps young people with mentoring, financial education, as well as microloans for those who are brave enough to start their own company.
Well, we are lucky to be joined by MyBank's founder, Lily Le Penne. She's with us in the studio. Thank you, Lily, for taking the time to come in and join us this morning. Explain to us a bit more about what MyBank is. Is it a business? Is it a charity? Is it a social enterprise?
It's a combination of a charity and a social enterprise. So we still earn a lot of our revenue through charitable donations, grants and foundations and corporate partnerships. But increasingly, we're starting to develop a consulting arm out of MyBank that helps us to leverage everything we've created and sell it on. And we also started to charge schools for the services that we provide.
What inspired you to do this in the first place?
I was working in Bangladesh on microfinance, and I came back to the UK and realised that a lot of my friends were leaving university in huge amounts of debt and didn't know what APR was.
I mean, I did. I left university with a lot of debt. And I know for young people, especially today in the UK, because in my day I could get a government grant, but that facility is no longer available. So a lot of young people are even putting off thinking about further education because of the cost.
Absolutely. And there's a real fear attached to debt. I think about a third of young people fear debt over arachnophobia. And so we're seeing that it's a big issue. We're seeing that a lot of first generation students to go into university, for first generation within their families, are really struggling with this issue around how much will it cost me and how will I be able to pay this back. So we support them through a series of programs. One of them is called the UniDosh program, which really brings to light everything they need to know around their money and their relationship with money throughout and pre-university.
Now, we heard yesterday from the Deputy Governor of the Bank of England saying that there does need to be more financial education in schools. What age are you aiming at? Are you starting young? Are you waiting until people are making that university decision? When are you trying to reach them?
We start at the age of 11 and we go all the way up to 25. We work in schools, we work in prisons, we work in youth organisations. And what we've really learnt is that the most important time to intervene is just in time. So just as they're about to make a transition in their life from primary to secondary, from secondary to an apprenticeship or to university, or when they get into their first job, we see that there are a lot of issues around starting to go into your first job, all the questions that come up around pensions.
Don't you think this should be a part of the curriculum though?
It is in schools.
It is already?
Yeah,
to what extent?
Happy to know. I mean, look, there are issues around it, but we campaigned, all of the financial education providers got together, we created an all-party parliamentary group, and we got financial education into the curriculum. The issues we're seeing now is that there's simply not enough government support going into teacher training or resources going into schools to pay for this. But what has happened is it's put it on the map. Teachers and schools know this is fundamentally important. And it means that organisations like ours are able to go in and access some of those budgets, although we really feel there should be more government support.
Clearly you're really sorry. I was just going to say you're really passionate about this, there's no doubt about it. It's something that you kind of started, as it were, but when you became a mum, you took more of a backseat or not? How would you describe the change in your role?
It's a good question. It became more blended. You know, there were certainly other priorities as well in my life. And so I went down a flexible approach. Guy Rigdon joined me as a co-CEO. We did an amazing job share for many years. And it's something I truly believe works. You get the best of both minds. We were able to have quality time with our families.
Now, you've worked across many countries. What's been your biggest success story or a story that's really stuck with you?
There's so many wonderful stories every day. I mean, just today I was reading about some of our young students in Senegal, where we've been working, who took out a small loan, and they set up a head massage company, and they were doing this around local markets. It was going so well. They were able to use the profit to build a library for their school. That was a fantastic story. In the UK, we see young people like, for example, Dan, who I refer to often because I got to meet him recently. He had applied for 80 jobs and got absolutely no response. He started to feel there was something really wrong with him. He joined one of our enterprise programs, took out a small loan, set up a project. was then able to go on site and visit different companies and realize that people working in businesses were not that different to him. He then applied for 12 jobs, got called in, I think, for 4 interviews and landed his first job. So we were able to turn around his mindset to feeling, actually, I have a place in the job market.
Lily, it's really good to meet you and all the best with what you're doing at my bank.
Thank you.
Thanks
very
much.
Very much
for coming in and sharing. Nice, positive money story there.
Warm feeling.